Here is the short demo of the finished project. And this video gives full, detailed coverage of the project on installing of the cornering lights onto the facelifted Mercedes models W or S 2012, which are equipped with the static LED headlights that have LED DRLs or side lights, LED low beam lights, and H7 high beam lights, and do not provide any cornering light functions at all.
Finalement été lancé dans la nuit, l'armée israélienne indique à l'instant que 99% d'entre eux ont été interceptés à ce stade.
Cette année, ils sont 4 compétition, les votes sont clos. Est-ce que vous vous souvenez, Johan, du gagnant de l'année dernière des villages préférés des Français?
Le sud,
dans le nord.
C'était
Esquelbecq, dans le nord.
Exactement.
Mais c'est vrai qu'il y a aussi de nombreux villages alsaciens qui sont...
C'est vrai, souvent c'est entre le nord et l'Alsace.
Il y avait eu quatre et la Lorraine cet après-midi. Les nuages se morcellent sur une petite moitié nord, avec un voile nuageux dense sur les côtes de la Manche. Et puis sur une large moitié sud, toujours le soleil et la chaleur qui restent présents. Les températures ce matin à Lille et Nantes...
On n'a pas encore mobilisé tout notre socle, se rassure de son côté un proche d'Emmanuel Macron. Manière de relativiser les sondages, de dire que les Français n'ont pas encore choisi, même si la légère fuite des électeurs du président en 2022 vers la liste de Raphaël Glucksmann se confirme. Il faut appuyer
sur le champ. Oui, le patron de l'ONU, Antonio Guterres, a condamné une grave escalade au Moyen-Orient. Il appelle l'Iran et Israël à faire preuve de retenue pour éviter un embrasement de la région. Le Conseil de sécurité des Nations Unies va se réunir en urgence aujourd'hui. L'Arabie Saoudite appelle aussi à la retenue.
To fit the cornering lights to our car, we have to purchase the three major components. The lights themselves, which come from the Mercedes 211, 204 and other mainly AMG models. They come as the fog lights, often with a cornering light function. They normally come with the standard H7 bulbs, which I decided to replace with the H7 LEDs from the company called Bivensee. We also need to buy a 5-volt 2-channel relay that will be switching these lights on or off. And our main part here is the Pico RP2040 CAN bus feather with 133 MHz clock, 8 MB onboard QSPI flash and 264 kilobyte of RAM, and has the CAN bus MCP25625 chip integrated on board. To identify the CAN bus frames and the values that they hold, I bought the canable board version 2 that we can connect to our PC via the USB-C port, which also works very well with SavvyCan, that is the CAN bus sniffing software that we use in this project. In other words, this car has already more than 30 computers, or technically they are called control units. But in this project, we are adding yet another very similar control unit. This control unit will be getting data from our vehicle's CAN bus and controlling our cornering lights, and probably some other components in our future projects. On all of my PCs, I am running Arch Linux operating system, and so all the screen recordings that you will see in this video are done under Linux. RP2040 processor has two cores and two programmable input outputs, each of which has four state machines. In this project, I use both cores and also use two state machines to switch our relays on or off. All programming in this project is done in Arduino IDE. And to have fully functional cornering lights in our car, we need to satisfy the following conditions. The main condition is that the cornering lights should be enabled when the ignition is on and the car is started, which means that we are bringing our Pico to life when the ignition is switched on. And thus, I am connecting my Pico to my vehicle's circuit 87F. And in this car, these are the fuses 33, 34, 35 and 36. Then, as we don't want our cornering lights to be on during the day, we need to know if it's the daytime or nighttime. We'll get that data either from our light sensor, or we can check if our headlights are on and switch our cornering lights based on the headlights. But this is not always practical, so it's better to use our light sensor. And after we know that it's the night time, we then need to make sure that our cornering lights are switched on when the vehicle speed is less than 20 km an hour. Most vehicle manufacturers enable their cornering lights at the speed below 40 km or 25 mph. But my own tests showed that when I am driving through a roundabout, my lowest speed is 25 km or 15 mph. And because all of these roundabouts are lit with lights, I don't really need to have my cornering lights on such roundabouts, because all that they would do is just to give more glare to other road users, and not very helpful to myself at all. It is important to understand that here we have full control of all these settings, and you can change the max speed and other parameters to any that you like. When our speed comes below the max speed, we can then see if our steering wheel is more than 60 degrees or any other angle from the center. And if so, then our Pico will switch the corresponding cornering light on or off. Also, when we are going through some mini roundabout at a low speed, we can check if we are signaling that we are exiting that roundabout. And if so, we can then switch the opposite cornering light on and the other one off. In practice, this will be used very rarely, but such function is still very useful. In this project, as you saw in the beginning, I am also giving a currently 3-second delay when switching off the cornering lights after use. So, from the Mercedes WIZ electrical diagrams, I found that my front SEM unit has many CAN bus connections, and I decided to tap into the CAN-B and CAN-E, which, as the diagram shows, are located in the plug 7i, pins 10, 11 and 8, 9 correspondingly. So I pulled off the front SEM and soldered my wires to the wires of the CAN bus B, where 7i is marked, and to the CAN bus E as well. I didn't cut the CAN bus wires, but simply burnt a bit of insulation and soldered to them my own 20 AWG twisted pair of CAN bus wires. And then I run them into the inside of my car through the hole that leads into the cabin and to the location where my Pico, or as I call it, driver's Pico, will be located permanently. I marked CAN E with green insulation and CAN B with blue. My driver's Pico will be connected permanently to the CAN B, and CAN E I'll be using for CAN bus sniffing with SavvyCan app. Also, we must remember that when we are connecting our Pico to the car, we have to cut the terminating resistor connection, because here we don't need to use any terminating resistor, otherwise CAN bus resistance will be far less than 60 ohm and our Mercedes will begin to swear from all sides. To remove the termination, simply make the cut on the Pico board, shown here with the vertical red line. You can then check the CAN bus resistance. It should be very close to 60 ohm. I connect the CAN low and CAN high to my canable board. I don't connect any ground wire to it because I connect my laptop to the USB power of the car that already provides the ground. Now, in our PC, we need to install software called CAN Utilities. So, in my case, in Arch Linux, I do yay synchronize with dependencies CAN Utils. You can also install, instead of this, CAN Utils Git. Then I do the following line to enable the modules. Then I set up SLCAN daemon, and as you can see, it is important to set the correct speed for our CAN bus. In my case, I connect canable to CAN E, and therefore I put S6, because my CAN E is 500 kbps. And for the CAN B, I would put S4 because its speed is 125 kbps. And if you know other CAN bus speeds for this car, then please put them into the comments below. And the dev TTY ACM0 is my USB port to which canable is connected. After that, I bring my SLCAN0 interface up. And finally, with CAN dump, we can check if canable is able to read the CAN bus. As we see, it reads very well. I terminated by hitting Ctrl-C. Now we can start SavvyCan software to sniff through our CAN bus. You can run it either as app image or install as normal app. In my system, it runs both ways. So, after we open it, we need to set up the connection. As shown, after setting up the connection, we can see that SavvyCan is already reading the CAN bus. The light sensor is located on the top right of our windscreen. To identify our light sensor frames, I am covering and uncovering the sensor to trigger generation of the frames in the CAN sniffer. And it looks like frames with IDs 37 in decimal are changing most frequently. So I then isolate frames 37, continue to cover uncover to trigger the frames, and it shows the values. As we see, the light sensor frames are only 1 byte long. And when fully covered, we get value of over 200. Which means the darker it is, the higher the value. With this sensor, keep in mind that there is about 2, 3 or 4 second delay depending on the configuration of the vehicle. In my case, I have set a 2 second delay with Vediamo. So our darkest value here will be set to 199 in our Arduino project. After we got our light sensor value, we can find the frames for the headlights. We do this in a similar way by moving our light switch to different positions and looking for the change in frames. As we can see, the frames with ID 69 in hex or 105 in decimal are changing when we move the light switch. For our Arduino project, we need IDs and values only in decimals. So, to have our cornering lights on, when our headlights are on, we need the value to be above 4. Now, my choice in the project is to rely on the light sensor rather than on the state of the headlights. I simply ignore the headlights, but keep the IDs and values in the project in case I need them in my later projects. The next data we need is our vehicle speed. While doing my research, I came across a file on the internet with some limited CAN bus IDs and values. That file is for the Mercedes 211, and only a few bits of information from that file are useful to me here. Among which is the fact that the speed taken from the CAN bus frame has to be multiplied by 0.0375, and that it is in miles per hour. And, as the tests shown, it is always 2 mph or 3 km lower than the speed displayed on our dashboard. And the frame contains data for each wheel. And, as we can see, we trigger the speed frames by slowly moving back and forth. And this way we identify frame with ID 203 in hex or 515 in decimal. And if we are not moving, all the values come to zeros. And in the first two pairs of bytes, first four bits are either 8 or 4. 8 when we are moving backward and 4 if we are moving forward. Now, testing the speed with Arduino serial, and the CAN bus value is always 3 km higher than the one on the dashboard. So, after we've got the speed, we can try to find the turn indicator frames. And we do that in a very similar way, by triggering the frames and checking with SavvyCan. And we have frame ID 41. We have 0 for no indicators, 80 decimal for touching left indicator. The last data we need to find is the steering ankle. To understand how this sensor works, I first open Xentry and move the steering wheel all the way to the left and then slowly all the way to the right and stop at the center. And we have full steering wheel range of around 980 degrees. So, in SavvyCan, I start short steering wheel moves left-right. And the frame that changes the most is the one with ID 3. And we know that in the CAN bus, the higher the frame priority, the lower the ID number. And so, I am moving the steering wheel fully to the left, then fully to the right. And then, try to get the values in decimal, and we have the range between 3100 and 5100, where 4096 seems to be the center. And, as we can see, the full range is around 1900. And that is about double of the values that we got from Xentry. And the center point would be at about 4096. So, now, we have all the data that we need to acquire from our CAN bus. And if your vehicle is different, the chances are that your values are similar to the values in this vehicle. This is because the steering ankle and other sensors are not made by the vehicle manufacturers, but instead are produced by different companies that produce and sell their products to many different car makers.